disease. So I'm going to take you through a little bit of the history of this disease and then talk specifically about what we've been doing here at Pierce and then what we hope to do. So we have a lot of questions. So if you guys have questions, absolutely feel free to stop midstream and fire away. All right, so let's just all get on the same page here. Wasn't that a fancy transition? I thought it was. Anyway, so if you work with venomous animals for long enough, especially venomous snakes, do you guys want me to just like stand up?
Oh, you're fine.
Especially venomous snakes, invariably you get the question, well, why do we even care? Why do we even care about conserving a venomous animal, particularly a snake, because they're not everybody's favorite creature, right? So what's the, I know what I say when people ask me that. What would you guys say if someone asked you that? What's your response?
They help prevent the spread of Lyme disease through small mammals.
Oh, that's a good one, Sarah.
That's what I always tell people when people ask.
That's a really good one that I
Because everybody hates ticks. More than they hate rattlesnakes, usually.
Yeah, that's true. Okay. Anyone else? I don't know what you guys.
Because, like, everything has, like, its own specific spot that they need to fill in when they leave.
Yeah. So these are important predators and also important prey species, right? And they have their place in these wetland ecosystems. So bringing attention to these snakes perhaps is going to bring attention to wetlands, and that's always a good thing, okay? So now that we're all on the same page. We care about rattlesnake conservation. I do. Let me talk a little bit about some fungal pathogens really quickly that have been affecting wildlife species. So when I first started in this whole world, I wasn't geared at all towards diseases. I didn't think that was something that I was going to do. There's people now that study disease ecology, right? That's their sole focus. But working with these animals long enough, particularly reptiles and amphibians, you end up dealing with diseases. And fungal pathogens have been particularly bad for amphibians, and also now for bats. And now we have this snake fungal disease that's on the scene. So some of you, I know, have heard of this fungus, Batrachum chytridium dendrobatidis, that causes chytridiomycosis in amphibians and frogs and toads. So all of these fungi that I'm going to mention are keratinophilic fungi. So they eat keratin. They like to feed on keratin. And what is the primary ingredient? Skin, hair, nails, scales. It's keratin, right? So these are all things that affect the skin primarily of these species. And so for chytrid fungus, this is a fungus that feeds on the skin of the frogs, and it interrupts or basically halts their ability to osmoregulate, right, to transport water and nutrients across their skin. If you're an amphibian, that's huge, right? They have very permeable skin. And so we've seen pretty massive global declines from chytridiomycosis in lots of amphibian species. And then, of course, I'm assuming a lot of people know now about Pseudogymnoascus destructans. It used to be geomyces. They changed the scientific names, the genera of these fungi as we learn more about it. This is the fungus that's responsible for causing white nose syndrome in bats. And this is another one that affects keratin, and it causes bats to basically come out of their hibernation and to start metabolizing, and they end up dying. And of course, we now know that this disease has been responsible for huge declines in bat populations, right? To where now we have lots of species that were once extraordinarily common, now they're listed on the endangered species list, which is super unfortunate. So now we're dealing with our famous fungus snake here. Now we're dealing with a fungus that's very similar to, now we're learning, it's very similar to the fungus that causes white nose syndrome in bats. And this is Ophidiomyces. It's a fungus that is specific to, we think, specific to snakes. It causes these, let me see if I can sort it, these dermal lesions that you see here. So this is a snake from Pierce Cedar Creek that these guys have been following this summer. And it tends to affect the head, but also you can get lots of lesions on the body. And for our favorite little rattlesnake here, the Eastern Massasauga, it's led to lots of mortality in the cases that have been brought into captivity. So we don't know what's going on there. So let me take you really quickly through the timeline of this disease. So when we first started seeing white nose syndrome in bats, it sort of moved from the eastern U.S. all the way across to the Midwest and down into the south, and we have yet to see massive effects out west. Snake fungal disease is kind of doing that, but it's been a little bit less predictable. So we first saw this disease in timber rattlesnakes in New Hampshire. Well, I should say it was first recognized as a serious pathogen. Okay, so there was a population of timber rattlesnakes out in New Hampshire that was already isolated and lacking genetic diversity and had lots of problems already. And then they started seeing snakes with these lesions on their faces and their bodies. And it caused lots of mortality. So that was back in 2006. We didn't know it as ophidiomyces then. It was just suspected to be some kind of fungal infection. In 2007, timbers also turned up in Massachusetts with the same fungus. And then in 2008, this is our Massasauga down here, a population in Illinois, in Carlisle Lake, started showing signs of this disease, and the fungus was confirmed in eastern Massasaugas. In 2008 in Illinois. So you might be thinking this is a fungus that only affects venomous snakes. Well, it's not. Then it started turning up in racers in New York and New Jersey, and then a few suspected cases of different species in the middle there. And then we started to see copperheads out east in New Jersey in 2011, and ringneck snakes, so again, not a venomous species. And then in 2012, cases started turning up in the Midwest. So we saw them in timber rattlesnakes in Minnesota and suspected in Neurodia and water snakes in Michigan. So that leads us to our eastern Massasauga cases in Michigan. So in 2013, there's a population up in Grayling. And they started noticing that their snakes were turning up with these lesions, facial disfigurations, and a couple of individuals were actually brought in for potential treatment or euthanasia, really, if they were that bad, and they ended up dying. These two snakes ended up dying, and so we knew then that this disease was in Michigan and it was affecting our little native rattlesnakes. Okay, so this is taken from a publication that came out earlier this year. This is kind of the known distribution now of snake fungal disease. So there's been a lot of cases that have been suspected to be this disease or something related to this. There's a fungus that's relatively common in captive reptiles that's very closely related to this. So these are pretty much confirmed cases. So you can see that it almost parallels the white nose distribution in bats, although there's more gray states for white nose. Okay, so known affected species that we have seen this disease in, Cedarus, so this is a genus for Massasaugas, but also for pygmy rattlesnakes, which are down in Florida. We've seen it in a population of pygmies down there. Crolus, this is the timber rattlesnakes. Achistrodon is the copperheads and the cottonmouths, so we've seen it in all of those venomous species in the wild. But it doesn't, again, just affect venomous species. We've seen it in a whole host of non-venomous species as well. So these are our garter snakes, ringneck snakes, and racers, and rat snakes, and then our water snakes there. So we've lots of cases now cropping up in the landscape, so it appears to be somehow spreading. But we don't know how. All right, so let me tell you a little bit about what we know as of right now about this fungus, which isn't a whole lot, really. So I like people are starting to call this OO. I like that better than the actual name. So the Trachycotrium we call BD now, and Pseudogeomyces is PD. So I like OO. We're going to go with that, I think. So again, this fungus is keratinophilic, meaning loving keratin. It feeds upon keratin and grows very well on keratin. So it likes snake scales and skin. So it tends to be associated with these nodules, granulomas, which are just, that's basically an immune response, so a kind of a cluster of white blood cells in there. Eye infections, blindness you get sometimes, facial disfiguration, so I'll show you guys some photos in a second. And then ultimately, these infections can go systemic. So in eastern Massasaugas, they can go into the muscle tissue and into the bone. The fungal hyphae actually can grow right into that tissue, which is a bad thing. And so the snakes ultimately end up dying from lots of different things. It might be pneumonia or some other kind of secondary infection. So we do have some information about now about the temperature at which this fungus grows best. And so think about what a snake would be doing, right? We know that the fungus grows best at about 77 degrees Fahrenheit, and that it stops growing at about 45 degrees Fahrenheit. So this image right here is taken from this paper that came out earlier this year, just showing no growth down here at a cold temperature. So this is the fungus growing on plates, right? And then the best growth at about 25 degrees Celsius or 77 degrees Fahrenheit. So if you're a rattlesnake, yes?
Does the growth like stop or does it completely die off?
It just stops.
So it just halts and
yes. Yeah. It doesn't completely die off. So you could have them reinfecting again in the spring. Yeah, that's a good question. So what probably happens is the snakes go into overwintering, and if you're in a cold environment, maybe that fungus dies back a little bit, but then you emerge in the spring, and then you start basking, and that's good conditions for the fungus to grow again. So very different. This particular aspect of this fungus is different from Pseudogymnoascus, which is the white nose fungus. That one grows best at cold temperatures. And why? Because bats live in caves, right? So the fungus does really well in caves. Not like this one. We also know that this fungus is tolerant of a really wide pH range, so 5 to 11, which is pretty, that's a lot. That's going from acidic to very basic, which means that it has the ability probably to live in lots of different environments. We also know that it can grow on dead tissue, so it can grow on dead fish, dead insects, and crayfish. So again, it's probably present in the environment, but we just don't know that yet. So these are all lab results. Yeah, Keith.
What about higher temperatures? Is it like BD? Can you get hot enough to kill it?
Yeah, so the max temp here was 35 C, and it was still growing. So this snake would be dead at that point. Yeah. So there's probably a temp that you can get above which it kills, but it's too hot for the snake. So, good question. So snake infection by this fungus is probably opportunistic. We're guessing it's probably in the environment somewhere, and then the snakes are just passing through it and becoming infected. Why they're becoming infected, we don't know yet. And where they're being infected and how they're being infected, we don't know that either. You saw that map, right? There were cases that kind of cropped up out east, but then they came down to Florida, and then to Minnesota, and then to Michigan. So it wasn't this spread that you would think, oh, maybe it's just because of direct contact with infected individuals. But snakes are a big thing in the pet trade, right? So there's a lot of captive animals around. Sometimes people do release pet snakes into the wild. I have no idea if that's related to this at all, but it's been suspected as a potential way of maintaining this fungus, I guess. So like I said, there's a Chrysosporium species of fungus that's very common among captive reptiles, so lizards too can get this. And so that may have something to do with it, but we don't know. Okay, gross photo time. So I just wanted to show you some examples of what this looks like in other species. You guys have, the students anyway, have probably seen some of the Massasauga stuff that we've seen. But so this is a photo of a timber rattlesnake that has a fungus on its face, obviously. You can see that I believe what happened here is these snakes are much bigger than eastern Massasaugas. So Massasaugas are a couple of feet long, right? Timbers can get much larger than that. They can clear this disease. They've been brought into captivity and treated with antifungals, and they shed it off, and they just heal it over, and they can be fine. Massasaugas haven't been shown to do that at all yet. So it could be a size thing. We don't know. But this is most likely was a big, crusty, nasty scab, and the snake probably shed, and it's blind now, I'm assuming. But this will most likely heal over, and the snake will probably be okay. Here's another example in a timber rattlesnake. of, you see this kind of crusty lesion here, and you've got another one over on this side. So it's really common that it affects their face, and that may just be because a snake leads with its head, right? So it's moving through the environment, leading with its head, picking up whatever's out there. And there's been some speculation that the fungus might actually enter through the heat pits on the front of the snake's face. And so you commonly see an infection right here, or in the eye, or close to the eye. There's a garter snake. This is what it looks like in a non-venomous species, so, or what it can look like. It doesn't look that bad, right? You just have some crustiness here. The eye cap is a little bit cloudy. That's not normal. They look like that when they're shedding, but this one doesn't appear to be shedding. So just a little bit of crustiness there. Here's a Massasauga that was from that Illinois population at Carlisle Lake that was brought into captivity and has really pretty severe facial deformation. This is not what these snakes are supposed to look like. So pretty severe deformation there. It does still have its eye, but not looking so good. Originally, when it was discovered in Massasaugas, we thought it only affected the face. But now we know that you can have lesions all over the body, basically. This is a snake that was from the population up in Grayling with, out in the wild, a big crusty scab on its back. It's really indicative of this disease. Okay, so that's kind of what it looks like in different species. So why do we especially care about Massasaugas here in Michigan? Basically because for this particular species, Michigan is where it's at. They are not doing well throughout the rest of their range, but they are doing relatively well in Michigan. Still have some populations left. They are small-ish and isolated, some of them anyway. So conserving Massasauga populations in Michigan is really pretty critical. Okay, so let me show you. Ooh, you won't be able to see this, but if you could, just squint a little bit and look. So the range of the Massasauga goes, how much coffee did I drink today? Goes like right around there. Okay, so you've got them in Michigan, up into Ontario, and then in all this sort of tier of states right here, where we did historically anyway. The range is drastically reduced now. It still covers that distribution, but the number of populations is just, you know, much, much less than it would have been historically. This is kind of the historic, I would say, distribution of counties where there are occurrences in Michigan. So everywhere aside from Michigan, these snakes are either listed as state threatened or state endangered. And in Canada, they're also listed as threatened, with the exception of Michigan, where there's still a species of special concern, which is better than threatened or endangered, right? And they've also been on the candidate list. They've been a candidate species for listing on the Endangered Species Act for like 15 years now. So that's a long time for a species to be sitting on as a candidate. And so the Fish and Wildlife Service is going to make a decision about whether or not these snakes, or should anyway, I say is like so confidently, but should make a decision about whether or not these snakes are going to be listed at the end of this year. Sorry, Sarah, I thought you had
a... Oh, no, we're good.
Okay, so Eastern Massasaugas, everybody will recognize this, hopefully. This habitat, this beautiful habitat here, it's right over there. This is pretty typically what they look like. They're kind of a weird rattlesnake. They live in wetlands, right? Most of the time you think of rattlesnakes as living in dry environments. Wet things are good for fungi, so that possibly has something to do with why we're seeing these snakes infected with this disease now so commonly. And they also do another weird thing. They act like other rattlesnakes in that they're live bearers. They give birth to live young, and we'll do it in a couple months here. Pretty typical rattlesnakey body, nice heavy body, triangular head with the rattle, obviously. But they overwinter alone for the most part, which is weird. A lot of snakes will go to a big communal hibernaculum, and they all pile in there on top of each other and overwinter. These guys spend their winter in crayfish or rodent burrows, and most of the time they're not with other individuals and they're not with other species, but there's obviously exceptions to that rule. But that's generally how it works for these snakes. So these burrows could be very important for this disease, right? They could be a place where the snakes are picking the disease up and where the fungus is living. We don't know that yet. I keep saying these, we don't know.
I recently read a book called The Sixth Extinction by Elizabeth Colbert.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So she mentioned white-nose fungal disease in mm-hmm. bats and implicated human activity, that you
yep.
know, things would get moved around by ships and planes the way they never used to.
Yep.
I was wondering if there was something similar with these snakes.
So it's, we've totally speculated about that. We don't necessarily know. So with the bats, they had a big problem with people caving in those caves, right? So going from cave to cave, exploring the cave, picking up the fungus, and then transferring it to another cave. We could be seeing the same thing here, where people are actually, or dogs even, are transporting this somehow in soil, on boots, on car tires, whatever it may be. We don't know that for sure, but that could very well be the case.
A couple of years ago, I was walking around this lake in Barry County, and I got to talking with the DNR officer. He said there was rattlesnakes around there. He said they knew where they were, but they weren't going to let it be known to the general
yeah.
population because they didn't want a million idiots in there looking for
yep.
them.
Yeah, that was wise, yeah. Yeah, we aside from, I mean, we publicize things, obviously, but we try to keep the exact locations of things outside of Pierce, obviously, quiet for that reason, because there is still a problem with reptiles and people poaching reptiles. Even in Michigan, turtles get poached all the time. Rattlesnakes probably get poached, we just don't know about it. So yeah, that is totally still a concern for sure. That's a good question. Okay, so what have we been doing? Here's Danielle out catching snakes, and this is named Jeff down here, in case you can't tell. So we've been doing a mark recapture study out here for the last 5 years, and the goal of this study was to basically estimate some basic parameters about this population that we don't have for a lot of these populations. Actually, for really any of these populations, there's a couple out there that we know things about the demographics, but we don't know how big these populations are. So that was one of the goals of this study, was to estimate population size. And then to get an idea of survival rates, these basic demographic parameters that we just don't know. So in the middle of it, we got this disease on the landscape. So that's kind of cool, right? Not cool, but it's cool from a learning standpoint. Now we have some data before we detected the disease, and now we can keep track of the population afterwards and learn some things about what happened. So I know a lot of you have been in the lab while this has been happening, but for folks that haven't actually handled venomous snakes before, you stick them in tubes. That's what we do anyway. These clear tubes, and then you can do what you want with the end down here while the business end is minding its own business. And so we've been collecting, see, I told you guys we're in the future. We just collect sex, we weigh, we measure, we take a blood sample, and we mark them with pit tags, right? So the same thing that your dogs and cats now get, which have just really revolutionized wildlife research. So it's a permanent tag, a little microchip that goes underneath the skin, and then every time we re-catch one of those snakes, we scan it, and we know exactly who it is. So that's pretty huge, and using that data, we can estimate all sorts of things. And so we're on year 5 of this study, so hopefully we'll continue it into, with Pierce's support, we'll continue it for the long term. So this is kind of what the data looks like. These are our individual capture locations from 2014. I just said we don't publish these, but you guys know the landscape. So when the disease was detected in grayling in 2013, the Fish and Wildlife Service came and they wanted us to basically start swabbing our snakes to see if we also had the disease. And so they were interested in looking at a couple of other populations to see whether or not it was across the landscape or if it was just isolated in this one population up in grayling. And so right around that same time, a colleague at Northern Illinois developed a quantitative PCR test, which is basically a way of taking a tiny, tiny little amount of DNA, amplifying it, and quantifying it. So it's going to tell you whether or not you have fungal DNA there and what kind of loads it's present in. And so all we have to do is take a little skin swab and we can basically get all that information. So we've been guessing that the most likely place this fungus is going to turn up is somewhere in the face of the snake, and most likely in the heat pits. So we do our best to stay far, far away and shove this really long swab down there to actually get it inside the heat pits and twist it around and hopefully pick up fungal DNA that way. So these are results from the fungal screening in 2014. So basically, let me just walk through this really quickly. So three populations, this is us, this is grayling, and this is another population southwest of us, elf. We screened about 100 individuals total, 40 from Pierce. You can see the age breakdown here. Most of these were adults, just because that's mostly what we find. We did have a few juveniles in there. And then, of course, the one major take-home message here is that all three of the sites had positive snakes for SFD. Here's us, we had one positive. Two positives at grayling and then two at elf. And here's the prevalence that we saw for positive snakes. And then confidence intervals. So the real prevalence is probably somewhere in there. So the major take-home messages are, we looked in three populations and we found it in all three populations. Big downer there. And in one of those populations at elf, we had positive snakes that were not actually showing signs of the disease. So the fungus was on snakes, but they didn't have any lesions, they had nothing that would make you think that they were sick.
Colonized but not infected.
Yes. So we don't know what that means. That means that they're going to become infected at some point, or once the fungus reaches a certain load, they're going to become, they're going to show clinical signs of the disease somehow. So, don't know. And then the other take home here from this table is that right now, it looks like the disease is there at very low prevalence. But again, we don't know how that's going to change over time. All right, so here's our one positive male from 2014, just to show some more pictures. And we even, when we found this guy in the field, we recognized that it had signs of the disease. And in previous years, we had not seen things that had made us think, oh, that snake is sick. So you can see he's got a kind of a crusty scab right here. And then in the next photo, when you get him in the tube, you can see his whole side of his face here is just all brown and crusty, and that's just not normal. So that just jumped right out to us. And sure enough, he tested positive with that qPCR test. So now we're doing this swabbing again this year to see what we come up with for this year, just to kind of track it over time. And then, again, we've had another snake that turned up. This is a female that is gravid, so she's hopefully going to have babies in the next month or so. And she's showing very obvious signs of the disease. But the thing that I almost am slightly encouraged by these photos, because this is what she looked like when she was first captured early. Actually, I think you guys first got her in May sometime, but this photo was from, start of June. She looked really bad. Her mouth was open, couldn't really close. She looked totally blind. It looks like there's an eye in there somewhere, but I don't know where it is. And she's got this huge lesion on her face. And it stuck out when you looked at it from above, so it stuck way out on the side. But then we recaptured her a couple weeks ago, or not even a couple weeks ago. And she looked like she had shed, obviously, in there at some point, maybe even a couple times. She almost looks like she's starting to heal up a little bit. Cross fingers, maybe? Eye cap is still all cloudy and pretty nasty, but this hopefully is something positive. We've swabbed her again to see if she actually still has the fungus that's detectable. So we'll see. The beauty of doing this kind of long-term thing is we can hopefully keep track of her and see what happens to her. And if nothing else, hopefully she puts her babies out there before the disease gets her. All right, I'll give you a short list of what we know and then the longer list of what we don't know, okay? So SFD is here, this disease is present in the landscape, it's in Michigan, it's across the eastern and southern U.S., probably in lots of Massasauga populations, but we've only now looked in three in Michigan. Soon to be this weekend, four. it's also probably in lots of different snakes. So we haven't really looked a lot at other snake species that inhabit the same sites as Massasaugas. We know the fungus grows best at warm temps, not at cool temps, but it also is not inhibited at very, very warm temps. We have this qPCR test that does work to detect the fungus, but it also has some issues with false positive results, or false negatives, I should say. Bleach kills it. which is a good thing. So we should invest in Clorox because we use lots of HM. And we know that infected Massasaugas can survive over the short term. So in talking to folks up at Grayling, they've had a snake. They do radio telemetry up there, which is where they put the little transmitters in. They can follow their animals around. They've had a snake that's been sick up there that's had SFD. That's overwintered 2 years in a row with the disease. And she still doesn't look terrible. So being that... So we know that in the wild they can survive over a couple of years at least. And being that they are ectotherms, right, so they're not constantly metabolizing, things take a very long time. So even if she's on her way out, it's probably going to take a very long time. Okay, that's the short list of what we know, what we don't know. So we don't know how snake fungal disease is transmitted as of right now. We don't know if the disease is in the environment and where it is in the environment. And whether or not there are other species that are overlapping with Massasaugas that may be contributing to the transmission dynamic somehow. So that's a major question. We don't know whether Massasaugas can live through this disease. Right now, just anecdotally talking to the other folks working on Massasaugas, nobody has seen a snake live through this, a Massasauga live through this. Other species can. So hopefully we will be the first. We don't know whether the disease affects behavior. You would think, knowing anything about a reptile, reptiles, when they're sick, they tend to bask more. So you might think that if you have the disease, and with our one sick snake this year, that may be happening, but it's all anecdotal at this point, you would be out basking more, trying to clear that fungus. It's kind of inducing a fever in yourself, because that's the way ectotherms do it. And there could be some indirect mortality from that, right? If you're a snake that relies on crypsis, you might be out basking more, and a hawk will come down and pick you off more likely. So we don't know about that either. We also don't know whether this is a primary or a secondary infection. There may be some underlying pathogen that is stressing these snakes out, and then this opportunistic fungus is able to come in and cause this disease. And we also don't know whether sick or healthy snakes are infected, or both. Other stressors that may be compromising these snakes, so there's a whole host of things that could be possibly compromising these snakes. So people have talked about environmental pollution, possibly. So lead in the environment has been a big problem for lots of other species, not necessarily snakes. A whole host of things. Genetic diversity, these are really isolated populations, so we haven't really looked a whole lot at that yet. And then lastly, we have no idea how this disease is going to affect these populations over time. We know that when they're brought into captivity and they're really sick, they die. But does that mean that if they were left out in the environment, they might be able to clear it? Even if we have a low level of mortality, what does that mean for the population? Is it going to cause these small populations to totally crash? We have no idea. So this is why long-term data are extraordinarily important. All right, so I will leave you with where we're going from here. Here's the crew from the summer, just super excited. So we'll leave on a happy note, all smiley, right? So we're going to keep doing the mark recapture, and we've started collecting, we're going to keep collecting these swabs to detect the disease, and the Fish and Wildlife Service hopefully will remain supportive of that. And then we started running, this is like hot off the presses data right here, people. We started running some blood samples through a flow cytometer, and what that does is it basically quantifies cells in a bloodstream. And so it tells you which ones are the red blood cells, which ones are the white blood cells, and whether or not there's anything else weird in there. And so it looks like, so this is, I'll tell you what this says. These are this is a blood sample from one snake. These are our red blood cells. The blue is our white blood cells, and then there's this other stuff in there, and we don't know what the other stuff is. It's possibly a bacterial infection. It's possibly the fungus itself that's gone systemic in the blood. This is with a sample size of like 5, so this is not at all definitive, but I get excited. So the other thing is that this, whatever this other thing is, appears to be correlated with the number of white blood cells. So that is possibly indicating that it is eliciting some kind of an immune response. But we don't know that for sure. Alright. So I'm going to leave you guys with a healthy, beautiful looking Massasauga, and I would be happy to. And thank you for coming out tonight and being part of pie and pizza, or if you do pizza. And I'll take your questions and we can discuss. Yeah.
How likely are you that it's an emergent disease or just one that we're just starting to pay attention to? I guess the reason I question it is because, especially with some of the detection in some of the non-venomous species, I mean, mm-hmm. the lesions look like the scale rot.
Right, or hibernation blisters. You know, people always talk about that too.
Yeah.
And there has, so Matt Allender's lab looked at museum specimens and they detected it in, I can't remember what species it was. So it has been around for a while for sure.
Well, and the species we found in person is ones that are super focused on and we're going to be more noticing, I guess.
Yep, yeah, exactly. Yeah, it's true. So it probably has been around for a while, but I don't think it's been like quite to this degree. I think it's probably been something that I just keep thinking that we would have noticed this kind of facial thing if it had been in these particular species for a long time. Yeah, it's a good question though. Maybe it's been in other species for a long time and we didn't notice it. I mean, people have been talking about, you know, oh yeah, we did, you know, we noticed these kind of blisters and scale rot, you know, crusty scales on the ventral surface and that kind of stuff. So maybe that was it, and now we're just now seeing it in for whatever reason, it's becoming bad for certain species. Yeah. Question.
How is scale rot different from snake fungal disease?
It may be the same thing. That was Keith's question. When this kind of first, I guess when people first started calling it this, there was this, you know, we didn't know what it was, right? When they first started seeing it in certain populations, we didn't know what it was. But there have been different fungal infections and things that have affected reptiles and snakes for a long time. So we don't know. May have been here for a while.
I heard you the other morning on WMUK talking about the value of rattlesnakes and certain medications that have been developed from snake venom. And I know that I read that Russell's viper venom is used to develop anticoagulant. I was wondering what kind of uses, medical uses.
So I've heard there's snake venom. Yeah, I've heard there's an arthritis medicine medication that's out there that's been developed from rattlesnake venom. And there's another one, and I'm not going to be able to think of it, what it treats. I don't know specifically.
Blood pressure.
Blood pressure. High blood pressure. Low pressure.
Yeah, I guess you're not, though.
Yeah. So, there's another reason I should keep it.
Also, with rattlesnakes, I've heard that sometimes it's with snake bites, they're hard to treat because there's different degrees of neurotoxin and hemotoxin.
Yeah, as far as I know, most venoms have, there's a number of different compounds in there that cause varying degrees of all of those things. So some are more than others. You know, rattlesnakes tend to be kind of more of a hemotoxin, but I'm sure there's, you know, neurotoxic properties in there too, but they're just not as strong as
the people I've talked to have been bitten by rattlesnakes as it hurts like a mofo.
Yes.
As opposed to a cobra, which is, you know.
Yeah, yeah. I do my best to not
keep our fingers crossed on that one.
Yeah, for everybody, right?
One, you're going to have to do a cobra Tuesday.
Yeah, all right. I do actually have, someone sent me this video of, it must have been back in the, I don't even know, it's in black and white, so however long ago that would have been, maybe in the 40s or something even, of, it was like a news report, all these people are crowded around, including all these kids, and this guy just voluntarily gets bitten by a Massasauga, and they like follow him, you know, what happens to him, and he's doing all the things that you're not supposed to do when you get bitten by a rattlesnake. He does the cuts, you know, and has someone sucking it out and all this stuff. And they literally just follow this guy. So how are you feeling now, Ned? And he's like, well, it's not so great. As his hand is just, you know, working up. Yeah. I don't think we would get away with it. that.
I'm just curious, I mean, obviously it affects more of the space snakes. Does it affect any other reptiles? Is there any evidence of like turtles or lizards or whatever?
Yeah, so it's really closely related to this chrysosporium that does affect other reptiles really commonly. But this one has, genetically speaking, it's different enough from that that they've called it a phidiomyces and it's its own snake-specific thing. So far, you know, it's just, we've only seen these kind of cases in snakes. But it's very closely related to this other fungus that affects lots of different reptiles. In fact, this fungus was included in with that genus for a long time. We just assumed it was chrysosporium, and then it, the genetic information told us otherwise. So like Carlisle Lake, the one in Illinois,
yeah.
I mean they've been studying that thing for like 20 years.
Okay.
College. 20 years probably.
Yeah.
I don't know, 15 years.
But much longer than you notice the fungus there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think so.
Okay.
Yeah. And same with that New Hampshire, the timbers out in New Hampshire. That was a really long-term study, like 30 or 40 years of data I think they had on that population. Both of those populations though are just not good. There were all these other things wrong, and then all of a sudden this came on the scene. And so those are the kinds of things that make me think, you know,
that it's new.
That it's new, at least for these species. But maybe it's just been in garter snakes and brown snakes or whatever, and you just didn't weren't paying attention.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, maybe there is a receiving of faces of corallids as the heat pits, and that's.
That's where it gets in. Yeah. And it makes it so obvious and it invades deeper maybe then.
It just seems like, you know, the dispersal pattern doesn't make any sense.
No, it doesn't.
Having spread, it doesn't, you know,
yep.
I don't know. I guess I just keep thinking that we're missing something else and that's what's stressing it, and then that stress level is then making this a problem that it wouldn't otherwise be.
Yep, I agree completely. I think there's probably something else there that we're missing. Some piece of the puzzle that's missing. I don't know what.
So Jen, you had mentioned snakes getting pneumonia. Like, what sort of illnesses do snakes get, and what does like pneumonia look like in snake form?
I don't know. I've never seen a snake with pneumonia. Keith, you might know. Have you ever seen a snake?
That's nasty.
Yeah.
It's the same sort of thing you see in any other animal.
Do they cough?
You have discharge, wheezing, bubbling,
I
think of any fungal pneumonias in humans.
I think I've seen pretty much every disease that you can think of in a person in the snake.
Yeah. Hmm. Yeah. It just takes a lot longer for them to die of it, probably, in some cases.
Depends on the disease.
Right.
I mean, you know, everything from like pneumonia to cancer to.
Yeah.
We even lost a blood constrictor with skin cancer. I didn't say I'm coming.
Wow.
Hmm.
That's crazy.
Yes.
Toxidiomycosis, I guess.
Yep.
The other thing is, I think snakes are also more susceptible to pneumonia because of the whole lung issue.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So they don't have two great big functioning lungs.
Just have one skinny lung. Right.
In fact, there's a lot of snake species that are desert species that we commonly lose in captivity pneumonia because the immunity levels are so much higher, or keeping them to where they're needed.
Mm-hmm.
So pretty much like all those Australian species, put them in human climate, they don't do well.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess in the longer term, if you see yourself, say, you know, 3 or 4 years from now, probably, you know, still studying these guys, what sort of data would you like to collect to be able to track this long term? So obviously this immuno sort of assay that you're doing, and then obviously like the fungal assay, but I guess what other sorts of data would be helpful? And
I think two things. One is I would love to just see where this stuff is in the environment. people have talked about using environmental DNA to do that, possibly. So then we can finally put to bed, you know, it's out there. It's probably been out there. You know, it's not just in burrows, it's everywhere. It might be in the soil, it might be in water, whatever. So that would be one thing. I would love to get a time series of the progression of the disease in individual snakes. So what do they look like across the board? What is their immune response over time as the disease progresses? Do they clear it? You might have just opened Pandora's box, Sarah. It's not like, ooh, yeah, I'd really like to know that. I would really like to see what kind of things are possibly also stressing these snakes. So do they have high levels of some kind of environmental pollutant? Is there some other bacterial, fungal, viral pathogen that they've got? What else do we need to know? On a much broader scale, I would like to just see where this thing is in these populations in the state. If everybody's got it.
Yeah.
So we're going up to an island this weekend, Snake Island. And we're gonna sample for it up there. So.
Snakeation, is that what somebody said?
Vacation, no. Snake vacation? Yeah. Snakeation. Yeah. So all those things from the snake.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
That's kind of fun.
Yeah.
I would say, and I guess this is one of the things I was thinking about, the environmental toxins kind of question.
Mm-hmm.
I know, like, it seems like, particularly for these snakes, they're not, like, top predators. They're sort of midway through the food chain.
Mm-hmm.
And so it seems like, I mean, it's possible, but I don't know. It seems like something we could test for, and it wouldn't be too hard.
Yeah. Someone mentioned doing stable isotope analyses,
mm-hmm.
Which would be kind of neat. Is that in your wheelhouse, Sarah?
I do know how to do stable isotope stuff, yeah.
We have to figure that out at some point.
Yeah. Are you planning on, like, chipping the ones with the snake fungal disease for telemetry so you can keep track of them?
You know, we've talked a lot about telemetry. Telemetry has been done a lot in these snakes, and the problem with telemetry is there's some pretty good evidence that it stresses the snakes quite a bit. So we've kind of operated under the assumption that that would be stressing them too much. It might actually put them at risk of the disease. So we're not using telemetry at this point.
I mean, like, just the ones that already have the disease, so you can, like, track it.
No, there's no plans to do that at the moment. Basically for those reasons. I think, you know, it's hard to learn about something if you feel like you're adding to it, which is kind of what I feel like we would possibly be doing with telemetry.
So the telemeters themselves, like, basically like outpatient surgery, you have to actually take them and do surgery to insert.
Yeah.
So it's not like just like the chicken.
No.
No, and it's not just like you glue it on or something like you do with the turtle. Yeah, it's a pretty major surgery. It goes intracelomic. It's inside the body cavity. The transmitter.
Do that on pipe. Torn apple.
It's exactly. Yep. It's the same thing, except it's more of an ordeal, I think, for snakes than it is for fish. They just put them in, you know, wood, and they go to sleep. And I don't know. For some reason, I think it's a bigger, more of an ordeal for snakes.
Just a comment on that. We had a telemetry study out here.
Yep.
The institute. And once those transmitters go in and stay in, even when the batteries run out, so that's, you know, kind of challenging to stay.
Yeah.
Even when the batteries run out. And we did find one a couple of years ago, I think, that actually, I think the part of the antenna was sticking out and causing some problems with it.
It's
not only can it make the snake more vulnerable, spread around that. Surgery that eventually, you know, can still cause problems years down, but it's
helpful. And in talking to the vets to, you know, there is some thought that any kind of open wound is a potential pathway for the fungus. And these, when you do these surgeries to put the transmitters in, I didn't realize this, but those wounds actually can stay open, like open to water for 6 months to a year, which is kind of crazy. So you're potentially putting snakes out there that are able to take in things in the environment through these wounds. So it's not on the horizon.
I'm trying to remember, the Carlisle population, one of their females that pulled in was grabbed too.
Yes.
But then those died, was that what happened?
They did, yep. That's that's the only evidence I think that anybody has that they can get, that snakes can get the disease from each other.
Yeah. That's just as interesting because you guys have to grab a female gene.
Yeah, I know. I kind of would have wanted to take her into babies in captivity.
I can understand.
We'll talk about that later. there was a gravid female that came in sick in the Illinois population. She had her babies in captivity, and they kept her in as sterile an environment as possible, and all the babies ended up getting the fungus and dying, and she ended up dying.
It does make me wonder if them being in captivity is actually, like, hurting the disease, because I assume it would be warmer in captivity than what it would be in their home environment.
It's kind of stressful.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yep. I've wondered that too. And that's why, that's kind of what we always come back to. Because people have asked too, why are you returning sick snakes back into the wild? And that's obvious to me. It's so that we can learn about the disease. And if they can clear it in the wild, then something's different out there. That they're not getting in captivity. It's less stressful or whatever. So, let's see. What's the old fungus snake?
Cool.
Neat.
I know, like, the timber raptors and Nessus hybrids, they, like, have to monitor how they survive.
Yeah.
Have they done that with any of the other species, or have, like, any plans to look at how they survive with the fungus? Like, maybe the other non-bacteria, mm-hmm. they do better or worse.
That would be another thing that I think would be really huge, would be to look at other species that aren't vipers. I don't know of anybody that's looking at it in other species, but there probably are people out there. I think, again, everyone's starting to pay a little more attention now. But that would be another thing to add to the list, is looking at other species that are out there.
That would be fun.
To see if they're just...
Because there could be like 3 years.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Brown snakes.
Oh, those as well.
Sneaky little brown snakes carrying fungus all over the place.
I mean, you guys have been looking for snakes. Have you actually been capturing some of these other snakes that you see?
We
haven't
talked about that.
Okay.
We've been swapping out herders.
Okay.
But
I see a lot of them before, especially bees.
Yeah.
We have more swapped
them. You haven't actually had a grad pool and just even looked at their.
We generally bring sometimes.
I was grabbing brown snakes.
Okay.
But I haven't noticed anything.
Okay.
You see those. I guess that's part of the reason I have an issue with this is emergent diseases.
Yeah.
You see those sores. I've been catching tons of snakes like that over the years.
Yeah.
You see them all the time. And it's this question, well, was that something else?
Right.
Was that a little injury? Or was that snake one
right.
disease? You know, all these other snakes all these times that I've seen.
Right. Yeah, I mean, it could just be that now we know what we're looking for, and now that we're looking for it, it's there.
It's like those garter snakes in Florida that tested positive. I've seen snakes exactly like that.
Mm-hmm.
I just thought, oh,
right.
Whatever.
Yeah. Yeah, I know. It's true. And people have been talking about water snakes around here, you know, having these hibernation blisters and scale rot and all sorts of things.
The chance of finding, especially in a water snake that doesn't have some sort of
something.
Scale rot issue.
Right, right.
Still.
But that's the question. What is that, you
yeah.
know? Who knows what that is? I think we just need to look a little harder and actually maybe say whether or not it... I would like to know if this has been out there for a long time and then for whatever reason it's just affecting these species really negatively now. You know. But it does strike me as odd, too, that you know, the timbers in New Hampshire, that population is just screwed. I mean, they had piebald snakes in that. You guys know what piebald... It's It's where you get like a melanistic, the animal will be like half white and half patterned. It's just a very rare genetic anomaly. Well, it's a mutation basically. And in this population, it was they were so inbred that it was in 25% of the snakes or something, they were piebald. So they were those snakes were obviously totally inbred, isolated, suffering from all sorts of things, and then started dying from this fungus. So yeah, same with Carlisle. I think that's probably the same situation down there. But why don't our snakes have it?
One of the things I was wondering, so you talk about isolated populations, small populations, like do we know what historically, or what would we consider to be a large population size, and is this something Danielle would be able to offer, like as far as when she's analyzing data, like how large would the population have to be to have enough genetic diversity to be maintainable?
There's been there have been a couple of studies that have looked at basically different genetic markers to say whether or not Massasauga populations have likely been isolated for a long time, or if it's a recent thing. And it looks like this is the way they've always functioned, as fairly isolated, which is a good thing. So whether or not that's gotten worse, I mean, obviously it's gotten worse, once their habitat's so fragmented now and so restricted. But I don't know what kind of an impact that might have. Yes, hopefully Danielle will be able to get at some of those things. I mean, that's always the question with genetic diversity, is you can't ever say, well, I guess you can. I take that back. It's very hard to say, we have enough genetic diversity versus we don't have enough, something's going to happen. So I don't think we'll necessarily be able to say that, but we will be able to say something.
It's just kind of like I don't really know, but like, what are museum specimens? Like, what do they look at?
Dead snakes. Yeah. Well, most of the time they're pickled.
Oh.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. They're in formalin or formaldehyde or whatever.
And you can still find the fungus that way.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. It depends on what they're preserved in. But usually that DNA can be pretty well preserved.
Mm-hmm. I would say there are more museum specimens floating around. Not even just museum specimens, but specimens.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I know Sandy would be able to comment on this. Like, there are a ridiculous number of biology teachers floating around who have, dead stuff
mm-hmm.
sitting around. Just, chilling.
No.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm a big fan of using dead things as much as possible. It's a free source of information.
One book I read called Hey Ranger, talked about these rattlesnakes that would swim into the Colorado River in Arizona, and it was cold, so they would go dormant.
Uh-huh.
And these fishermen saw it. They thought it was a dead rattlesnake in the water, and they picked it up, put it in the boat, thought, oh, this would make a nice souvenir. Snake came
back
around.
To life.
So the ranger got called. There was two fishermen standing on a small island on a boat going down
the river. Oh, no, with a live snake in it. Don't abandon your boat. I'm surprised that ended well with a snake. Cool.
Do you guys have a population estimate for your snake?
Mm-hmm. Tell us the latest.
Well, we have 80 individuals.
But we're talking about
last year was 65.
Yeah.
30 birds and
others. Decent sized conference.
Yeah, the confidence interval.
Like 30
something.
Something.
So, adult population size, we estimated at 65, plus or minus 25 or 30. So it's probably less than 100, over 50.
What's the overall acreage that there have been?
600. So the property is about 650 acres, right?
Although it actually just got bigger.
Yeah, it just grew.
We got a donation that we accepted last week.
750.
Something, yeah.
But the Massasauga habitat's probably...
About a third of the property is
of
wetland.
Mm-hmm.
My daughter's got a picture of Massasauga at Town Zoo.
Nature Center?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Uh-huh. Yeah. It was across the trails.
They have a few. I've heard. Our evaluator used to work there, and he's told us many stories. So.
Yeah, I mean, they're around. They're around this part of the state for sure.
Yeah. On that happy note, we can give Jen a round, and I will say, if you want pie. So
one other thing is I have a brief evaluation. If you don't mind taking just a minute to fill that evaluation out, that would be much appreciated.
Part of it's the whole, this whole series, we try to get ideas for new speakers.